Norman, it's a pleasure to have you here with me in Papo de Graça, which is my daily program. And I know some things about you that I want people to know the same way as I do. We are talking to Norman Stone, who began his professional career in television as the youngest producer director at BBC, moving from documentaries and pioneering children's show into popular drama. Norman produced and directed Tale from the Madhouse and received awards in series. He has been working at BBC One for many years and done so many things that I would prefer to let you know, people, in some other ways that we could communicate to you, because I don't want to lose my time. I want to go to the heart of the things. And right now, he's finishing up a movie on C.S. Lewis, The Most Reluctant Convert. But it's not the first thing he does on C.S. Lewis. He has done Beyond Narnia, Florence Nightingale, The Narnia Code, KGB, the book of the changed, the book that changed the world, and some other winning products and the productions that he did. Like he did Epiphany, he received the Epiphany Prize in 2012. And Norman, what I want to know is that you have just finished a documentary called The Final Fix about a remarkable new treatment for drugs addiction. And it's something very revolutionary. And I would like to start talking to you about this, because I saw some of the things that are available for a man like me to understand what is that. And I was amazed, because we are talking about a device that is not larger than a small cell phone that could be carried on the waist. And what he said there is that it's very useful, or more than useful. It's something that could be bring freedom to lots of people involved with many addictions, alcohol, any kind of drugs, methamphetamine, heroin, and whatever you want to name.
Yeah.
And how do you explain that this little thing based on little shocks could produce this reaction in the brain in such a way that after suffering for many, many years, people could be freed from all these addictions? How it works?
Well, it doesn't work with shocks. Let me correct you there. The interesting thing is, we have followed in what we might laughingly call Western civilization. We have followed certain paths. We chose chemistry over other forms of medicine. Chemistry is fine for medicine, but you do close your minds to other options. The latest growth medicine, I would say, if I can call it that, is electric medicine. There's a great deal happening now with electrical stimulation, implants, and so on, that the traditional people would not look at because it didn't make sense when you measured against chemistry. So pharmaceuticals, a very important thing, this, pharmaceuticals making their billions out of selling opioids and other drugs are doing very nicely, doing extremely well financially on the system as it is now, which is you replace your drug of addiction with another drug, you don't get off it, you just park there, but it's that's what they'd like. If you come along and say, here is a medical device which does not use pharmacy, no drugs involved, which stimulates, you can go to sleep with this little attachment on, it doesn't hurt or feel anything, but it flutters slightly in the, just behind the ear. It goes just a little, and then that dies down. In 5 days after using that, you will be healthy, fit, eating, sleeping. You will not have had cold turkey, those terrible things, the withdrawal symptoms. And when you have finished, 5 days later, you will have no more cravings ever. Now, I look at that and I say, wow, if that really works, that's the best news for an awful lot of people I know. But if I'm not me, if I'm a pharmaceutical person or stuck in the pharmaceutical medical world that has gone on for the last many decades, I would not want to know about it. I would feel there could be a severe loss of profit, which there would be if this was taken on. Or I would feel if I was, I'm having a battle with the Scottish government at the moment, I would feel it that it is the exactly opposite direction to where they are spending their billions to with addictions to try and keep people on their drugs and just stop them dying. I appreciate them stopping them dying. I do not appreciate that after many attempts, they are still refusing to look at this film and consider the claims of this medicine. They will not do it, which I think is a sign of guilt to start with. And you see me about to start a campaign that will embarrass the Scottish government into looking at the facts. I'm not saying buy it. I'm not saying tell me it's instantly fine. I'm saying look at it. Look at the evidence. These people getting off. Pardon?
Just try it.
Just look at it. Explore it. They won't even watch the
scientific about it. The same way they are with pharmaceuticals. They should.
Well, we've just had the worst. Yeah, we've just had in Scotland the worst drug figures ever, record breaking. And the government is going into the pharmaceutical way to try and deal with that, and it hasn't worked, and it isn't working.
Difference that we can see between Scotland and the other statistics in Europe. I was shocked with the difference. It's an epidemic that's going on there.
Yes, there are only 5 million people in Scotland. They spend, the government spends £9 billion, that was a B, £9 billion a year on so-called drug and alcohol treatment. The results from that, in terms of success rate, are 3%. 3% success rate for £9 billion in a country of 5 million people. The success rate, and I'm not selling this, I'm an independent filmmaker. I've just watched it work and told the truth. But I happen to know that the success rate in the same way for this NET, it is called, is 82%, and it costs next to nothing. 82%. Now, that upsets an awful lot of people who are doing well in the current system. But I'm sorry, people are dying. Too many people.
And what NET stands for?
It's the bad words. It says neuroelectric therapy, which everybody then makes the jump that you did earlier and think it's little shocks, which it isn't. It's a flutter, and it does something quite specific. We all have endorphins and enkephalins. Endorphins and enkephalins are the natural painkillers in the brain. But when you take your drug of addiction, they stop being produced. The more fizzy and extraordinary shots of heroin or whatever you take, whatever drug you're taking, take over, and you have a high, and your body makes less of the natural painkillers. Sure. But then you take more high, and then it makes less. And in the end, you're taking stuff just to feel normal. and that is addiction. And when you stop, it's cold turkey and horrible withdrawals. What this little device does, pulsing away, it restores you speedily to your own production of endorphins. Simple as that. And you get back. It's amazing to sit in front of somebody and watch them doing this. They just come alive. It's extraordinary.
Who developed this device?
A lady called Dr. Meg, or Dr. Margaret, her name is Patterson. She got a big award from the Queen for her work in Christian missionary hospitals all over the world, Nepal, India, and Hong Kong. And when she was in Hong Kong, she was a very much a respected surgeon and brilliant medical woman who'd given her life to the poor. She was using what had just come out of China, which was a little electrical stimulation device so they could do minor operations. It would stop the pain. And they would do minor operations, move your eye to the left, move your eye to the right if they're doing that. And they were using just that. And she didn't have any idea or awareness of that it did anything else. The Chinese were not surprised when this happened. I'll tell you what happened. In Hong Kong...
The Chinese were not surprised.
Well, in Hong Kong, you have so many opium addicts, heroin addicts, that the poor hospitals had a huge amount of opium addicts coming in. So when she did post-operative checkups, they said, ever since you use these needles, at that point it was little acupuncture needles, ever since you use the needles, doctor, I don't smoke opium anymore. And she said, thank you very much. Next. Yes, fine, thank you. Didn't believe a word. Happened again and again and again and again. And she was a brilliant medical brain. So she said, hang on, something's happening here that's physiological. And the story begins there. My film explains it. She tried it on Hong Kong addicts. She tried it on poor little rich kids, as they called them out there, with expensive parents that would pay for all their heroin they wanted. And they came off. And then she came back to Britain and Eric Clapton, the rock guitarist, came off. And for a while in the 70s, it was the rock stars, including Keith Richards, their rock stars' choice of, or at least their manager's choice of recovery, because it was so quick. And the managers could start making money again instead of waiting months with this junkie on their hands. So that was a news at the time, but none of the medical people would follow it through. They wanted to stay where they were.
Because you have at least two great enemies in relationship to this cure or device. The first one comes from the pharmaceutical industry that is going to lose billions or trillions of dollars if something like this works so simple and easily. The second has to do with psychology. It reduces the divan of psychiatry to another level and need, because all these other things in which we spend a lot of money and time without any kind of healing could be just healed by something very, very simple, which just makes enemies in many industries, powerful industries.
Yeah. I think there are three P's, the letter P. There's profit, power, and prestige. And that you cover everything. And people who have made their reputations in dealing with drugs, or rather not dealing with them, but trying to, and have learned all the usual stuff with pharmacology, suddenly find themselves that they're out of a job, or at least do not know anything about this amazing device that will heal you in 5 to 7 days. And they fight like crazy not to let that take their careers away. So we have the Scottish government refusing to look at the evidence, just refusing. I'll beat that one. I'm going to have a go at them. But the fact that so many people lose out means that we are not popular in the pharmaceutical people. We are not popular in anybody who's taking or running any other sort of often highly profitable rehabs or treatments for addiction. And we're not popular with governments because they've been spending $9 billion a year facing the opposite direction, which is all to say that human beings are not perfect. But I think human beings should be alive. And I think this, the quicker we get something like this to be looked at and tried out, in fact, it is going to be tried out, I believe, soon with another company coming in and offering NET. And suddenly it will collapse like a pack of cards, I hope, because you cannot have, say, this doesn't work. This is just placebo. While around the corner, people are getting off again and again and again and again and again. Be an interesting year.
What is horrible is that this pretense scientific judgment that is imposed, because science should be open. If I have one, two, three medicines and I don't reach what I really would like to achieve, and suddenly comes something simple that achieves what I'm not able to do, I should scientifically study these, and once that I can admit the achievability of what it's proposed, it should be included in processes of healing.
But Caio, it should be, it is human nature. This is not new. There is a whole trail in medical history of things that we are now absolutely relying on that were rejected for approximately, usually, 30 years. And that is about the lifespan of a medical doctor's career. And anesthetic was rejected out of hand. Penicillin was absolute nonsense for 30 years, both of them. So my first film on this was 46 years ago now. And when it came up to 30 years, and I thought, oh, this is when it's all meant to be accepted. Mm-hmm. And it wasn't. Do you know why? Money. This isn't just
always.
This is people making billions upon billions, like Purdue Pharma, the famous company that has killed 400,000 people and more. They're making money. So this is now up, it's so far over the 30-year mark. I'm determined with this film, and with a bit of effort, to make sure this gets somewhere.
Unfortunately, we have as much politics in science as we have in politics itself. It's horrible.
But can I say this? The in the history with penicillin and with anesthetic, the good always wins. It gets through in the end. And I have to believe that that will be true here.
Uh-huh. Yeah, that's true. Yesterday, I was looking at the resistances that some sciences had in the 20th century when it came to vaccines and many other things. All of them had bans in the beginning. Yeah. All of them. It was a great effort to get through. And nowadays in Brazil, our president is campaigning against vaccination. He is a man that we could consider, forgive me the expression, but we could consider him just a dumb person. He doesn't distinguish the right from the left, but he became a scientist. When it comes to vaccines.
I have hope that that will improve now we're in the situation we are in terms of Biden and so on. And yes, your president is noticed in the West very much. And what you said is no surprise. We are in a mess, this world. We've often been in a mess. And I don't think we just have to look after each other or ourselves. I think we can fight against it properly, and with common sense and with heart. And I think that's part of the job as a filmmaker that I've always enjoyed. Tell stories. I love telling stories, but I like them to leave people a little bit different at the end.
Yeah. And you are going to get yours. And maybe in 1 or 2 more years, we are going to meet each other in London.
I'd love that. I'd love that.
It would be my pleasure.
But well, I will hang on that long if you will hang on that long. We will wait together for that moment.
Yeah, it's going to be very happy for me. Listen, let's talk about C.S. Lewis, because you have a long-term relationship with C.S. Lewis.
Well, shall I tell you how that happened? Would you like to know how that
happened? Oh, yeah. I would like to know first if you got to know him personally.
No, he died in 1963. I remember the day very well when he died. It was the same day that President Kennedy was shot. But enough of that. What I did, I didn't know much about Lewis other than, well, I became a Christian when I was 16. And I was aware of certain things about C.S. Lewis, but I wasn't an expert. And I went and joined the BBC many years later after going to art college many years. And I loved telling stories and I loved making films. So when I got to the BBC, I worked there as a producer and director of documentaries. That was the main thing. And then I did another stint with the BBC, and it was in the end almost 5 years with the BBC, although I developed into drama, which I really like doing. That's the best way to tell stories. So I left. I didn't get paid by the BBC, but I was freelance. And I thought I just had a success with one film, my first real drama film. And I thought, well, I must find out other people to do it. And that particular film, the first film, was about a very interesting Christian man called Jack Clemo, who was blind and he was deaf and he knew God better than I ever will. He was great and he was a poet. I did that and I thought, why was that so successful? And I thought it's because he had earned the right to be heard. He'd been through the mill, as we say in Britain. He'd been through troubled times and bad and back again and retained his faith brighter than ever. So I thought, oh, I wouldn't mind that again if I could find somebody else. Bing! I discovered C.S. Lewis, who with his amazing relationship with Joy Davidman late in life, who got cancer, got better. She got cancer again. She died. That's where I wanted to do my drama. In fact, I took 2 of C.S. Lewis's books, Surprised by Joy and A Grief Observed, one of the most brilliant and tough books about loss, losing somebody that you'll ever get. That became later on a big feature film with a very famous director, Anthony Hopkins. And after that, I was launched into doing lots of dramas, which I loved and still do. So now I bring drama back to C.S. Lewis again for the first time in many, many years. And I take his early years, his struggle to faith after being an atheist and all this. And I try various new techniques in it, which is great fun. But that movie, it isn't for film in cinemas. All the cinemas are closed anyway. It's high, what we call high-end television, quality television. And I thought, wouldn't it be great to use Lewis's words and put it into really good filmic television, all with drama as well. And wouldn't it be interesting if he started, yes, we flash back to his earlier years, but what happens then if he starts to appear in his own memories? So he's watching his own life earlier, physically there. Mm-hmm. They can't see him. He can see them. And it becomes a very interesting way of telling a story. So it isn't out yet, but it will be soon. I will try and get you a copy or a link.
I would love it. We have a trailer over here.
Guys, let's be ready.
Yeah.
Hurry up.
Open the door.
Final checks, please, Harry.
Is this my chair?
It's
So have a red light and bell, please.
Where's my phone? Who has my phone?
Roll sound.
All right, how's my hair? How's my hair? Good.
All right, nice and quiet, please. Ready for a take. Cameras are rolling, set.
One take one.
Mark it. Quiet. Stand by. And action.
Cheers.
William Kirkpatrick, the great knock.
When we set out, I did not believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. The world and the flesh had made their appearance. Now came the devil.
So we need to leave!
That night, as I read Phantastes, my imagination was baptized. The rest of me took a little longer.
Do you know something that's interesting? We've been talking about COVID. I think C.S. Lewis, who went through the First World War and later, of course, went through the Second World War into the Blitz and so on, where Germany was bombing. There was a lot of death at that point. There was a lot of death around Europe and particularly in England during the Blitz. Never since that time when Hitler was bombing Britain, never since then have we had anything like this. Now we are getting thousands and thousands and thousands of people dying. And that is a wake-up call for people who are living the natural, easy, materialistic life. They were absolutely, oh, it's no problem. You know, live for yourself, go for pleasure, look after your own, buy lots of stuff, and don't think about death. Suddenly, everyone's thinking about death. And here comes Lewis again, with honest thinking and worldview. I think there's a connection there, and he may have another chance to really affect people if they engage with the film.
And listen, do you think that right now in England, there is an openness to absorb all this message that comes from Lewis? Because I think that somehow, the world is again getting close to the same spirit.
That's right. I think the motivation is now there, just on what I've said, apart from anything else, from the fact that everybody knows someone who's dying of COVID. Everyone's having to sit in a room under lockdown and not get on with their little pleasurable life. Everyone is affected by it badly. And if you don't think about eternity, about the meaning of life, and about what am I doing myself before I die, I think there's something wrong with you. And in thinking that, Lewis's words become all the more clear when he shows how he himself, with great struggle, reluctantly, hence the reluctant convert, the reluctantly came through and discovered, my goodness, this is real. Yeah.
It's like in The Silent Planet, Perelandra, The Great Divorce, all these books that show you the transcendence.
Yes.
That life is not only what the bombs can destroy. There is more to it.
You might be interested to know that Tolkien appears in our film.
Oh, yeah?
because he was very important in Lewis's conversion.
I want to see that. I hope the Christians in the world will also see this movie, because Lewis has to be rediscovered these times.
Absolutely. Yeah. But it is a true fact that C.S. Lewis is now selling more books than he ever has at any time since his birth, never mind death. It's now rocketing high. Do you know there is I think NarniaFan.com, I think that is what it is, a website and a group that have 6 million followers about C.S. Lewis. So he's ready to move on from that if this film works. But he is not forgotten, and his books are selling.
Good. And even over here in Brazil, now I can see many new people just getting interested. Narnia became a phenomenon in relationship to young people, children. But I would like to see his more profound and assertive books and messages being just as well known in the country, if you can. And I praise your film, and I hope it's going to get here as soon as possible.
I hope that too, but don't praise me until you see it. And even then,
No. when we see a trailer, we have a very good idea of what is waiting for us.
You just looked at the teaser. I edited that with my youngest son before I did any other editing.
Yeah. And what I was thinking over here is that we are in need of putting together some people who see the world in an average Christian way again, because since Billy Graham, that was the one that usually paid for people to get together to talk about things, was gone, we don't have anything going on anymore about it. But one guy that I don't know if you have any kind of relationship to him, with whom I would like to talk right now, is Frank Schaeffer.
Frankie?
Yeah.
You'd have an interesting time talking to him. I've only met him once. Frankie Schaeffer, if I can say this on your radio show, he'll sue me.
Yeah, you can say anything in my show.
But Frankie Schaeffer suffered from a bit of lack of parenting. His father was always in demand, his mother was always in demand, and he felt, whether he admits it or not, rejected. He is a bit of a wild card. He's not dumb, he's fine, but he will continually attack evangelical Christians, the things he subconsciously blames, I think, for taking his parents away, and also, he will not follow that path. He will attack that path.
Yeah. In my perception, he is a very traumatized Christian.
I don't know him very well, but may I suggest I can connect you with Oz Guinness.
You may include me there. I will have immense pleasure in getting to know your friends and the other ones that are there.
You are now at the table. Welcome to our table.
Thank you, Norman. And it was a pleasure talking to you. God bless you, my friend.
I must go and fight the Scottish government. Do take care. God bless.
God bless you. Bye.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.